There are not so many labels that cover as wide a spectrum as the London-based label Soul Jazz Records. It all started 20 years ago with a record shop. For Stuart Baker, the transition into a record label was merely logical progression. In almost two decades, quality records ranging from dub, reggae, ska and krautrock to world music and electro have all been released. In the meantime, books and DVDs have also become part of the soul jazz repertoire. One thing that soul jazz releases seem to have in common is a clear love of music and a vast openness towards sound.
The diversity came from, I think, after doing what we did for a couple of years, we took a step back and thought, I really like this music, but is this really how I would like to define what I'm going to do for the rest of my life, or am I interested in a broader picture, which was the case. And so through, first of all, possibly the record label, we started to push how far we could go in different types of music. So we would release Latin music and Brazilian music, and this sort of, went on and on, and to today where we can release acid house or Haitian voodoo or krautrock and it not be a problem. And the reason why it's not a problem and why we can do that is because of the sort of not manoeuvring, but the planning that we did 15 years ago to say, all right, if you like soul jazz records, it doesn't mean you like a type of music, it means you like an idea, and that idea will transfer through different types of music. I would say it's primarily dance music based, but not exclusively. Soul Jazz is an honest label, and I think probably that is what we've kept to, and that is what's enabled us to keep going. So, I maybe done 2-3 records that I've put them out and I've gone, shit, it really isn't a good record, and I really regret doing that. And the reasons for doing it would have been I'm obligated to do it, or I think someone else might like it, but I don't. And I did straight away that this is a real mistake. And the only thing you can really do is go, you have to present something that you believe in and like, otherwise people won't believe you. And it's quite hard to protect that sort of value. But yeah, that is what we do. The artwork is, I don't know whether you'd say it was recognisable or something, but essentially it's from the first day, it's been a friend of mine and myself who have planned them all together. So, they usually look like what they're supposed to look like, and we like things to look nice, so to our abilities. But in terms of the booklet and the sort of texts that go with it, it kind of developed. We did a couple of records. One was called New Eureka, which had a subtitle. Culture Clash in New York City, Experiments in Latin Music, 1970-77. It was kind of a joke, not a joke, but it was like, was anyone actually going to buy this if we call it this thing? And they were all records that no one liked, that Latin music people didn't like, that no one else had heard of. But I could I really liked them, and I could hear that, and I wanted to try and explain why, had I got it wrong? Were they crap, or was there some kind of historical, cultural thing you could see? And I sort of looked into it and found that there was, and tried to explain it. And as time went on, people read the booklets and quite liked them. And when digital turned up, maybe whatever it is, 10 years ago now, it sort of became clear that these booklets were, and the artwork was something that didn't translate very well digitally, which strangely enough became a strength, because it meant that our physical product, you know, CDs and records, they kept selling, whereas other one, you know, Elton John, I imagine, disappeared because there was nothing there. A CD became just a transmitter of audio files, and ours were making things, and that's, you know, when it became clear that was a strength, and that's what we've carried on doing, which is strange because I hate writing them. We have no marketing budget, so we don't do any marketing. You got to be efficient, and you know, a lot of the time we will be having conversations. Well, how can we make something look new or different, but without spending lots of money? And in terms of the market, I don't know. You know, it's not something I'm. I know why, but our records and our CDs sell a lot, and they haven't significantly decreased in the last 10 years, whereas most people's have. And probably that's something to do with the fact that we have carried on making something rather expensive that you can get rather cheaply, and because it's not transferable into cheaper form, you know, it's not, you can't really translate one of our products into a digital format, which is cheaper. And it seems to work at the moment, so I'm sticking with it. The music release isn't time orientated, which means that I personally don't differentiate between something created today and something created 50 years ago. You know, if it's new to me, it's new in my head. It's a slightly privileged view because I have access to, you know, having a record shop and a record label, you have access to a lot more music than. A lot more music, obviously I don't, because they can listen to what they want, but an access, a way of absorbing music and editing it that is slightly harder for a lot of people who don't have record companies or record shops. Although I can use that template to run a record label, I realise it's a slightly privileged view, and it's not one I'm necessarily wanting anyone else to, you know, care about, if you see what I mean. One of the main changes for us happened maybe 5 years ago, which was the with the advent of digital and the sort of chaos it caused with record companies essentially sort of not really being able to keep up with what was going on. We sort of took a step back and had to sort of reassess what we were doing, and we came to the conclusion that we liked making physical products as much as we were interested in music. And one, you know, basically, when things went digital, physical sales reduced. So we had the choice of either we could do twice as many things to compensate. We sort of worked out that books and DVDs were a physical products in a similar way that CDs and records were, that had packaging, that had the same principles, which was, you know, you license material, you photographs, you research it. So that's what we decided to become part of the record label. So we became a publishers and we started doing DVDs. And we apply exactly the same principles, which is, you know, essentially things that we like. And it works in a very similar way. And, you know, you have the same, essentially have the same structure, but you can make these different things, which has enabled us to change what we do, basically. So we can go from doing a music-related project to something else. But they're mainly all related to music, but from a, you know, music to CD to DVD to book, and it's made it, it's very sort of liberating thing, because it's meant, you know, we, essentially, as long as we don't lose people, we can do what we like. And that's where we are today. So it's a very, you find me a very happy person at the moment.